this week. I'd also ask tonight, we'll need cupcakes, brownies, cookies, if you could bring and come. We met this week, built this wall, me and Ted and some more. We did pretty good there, Ted, didn't we? Actually, we laid the foundation and then just get out of the way, and obviously the ladies turned it into a city. It was just boxes up here, but man, thank the Lord for just opportunity to serve. Just a couple things before I get into the message today. I was in North Carrollton last night. The church God called me to preach. I remember that church, Mr. Pope. He's actually, talk about a man of faith. My connection with Miss Rosemary and Mr. Charlton started with John Pope. He was a retired trooper. John Pope was just, man, he was a man's man. And he heard I was a new trooper, and he wanted to meet me. And he said, "Where are you living at?" I said, "I haven't found anywhere." And let me show you how Rosemary's all connected. It started with John Pope. We pulled up there in Mr. Charlton's yard, and he said, "Hey, Charlton," he said, "this guy right here is going to rent that house." He said, "It ain't for rent." He said, "Yeah, you're going to rent him that house." He said, "I ain't rent nobody in my house. Y'all get out of my yard." And I was like, so I drove off, and Pope said, "He'll rent you that house." I said, "I don't know if I want to live by that guy. He's an old mean man." He said, "He's fine." Next day, Sunday, about 1 o'clock, the Pope calls me and says, "Hey, come up here. He's going to rent you that house." I'm like, "Are you sure?" "Yeah, come on, meet him." I got him in the car. Pope said, he said, "I got in Sunday school this morning, the senior class." He said, in front of everybody, I said, "John Hooks, aren't you a Christian brother?" He said, "Yeah, I've been a Christian for all these years." He said, "Well, how come a brother in need, you won't let him rent a house, and you call yourself a Christian in front of all these folks?" He said, "Told me to tell you to come up there." So that's how I ended up my journey with Charlton and Rosemary. Well, Mr. Pope passed away this week, so I went to the visitation last night, and I just, man, I thought, man, what a dear saint of God. Just, he lived every day. But the reason I bring that up, pray for that church, little North Carolina Baptist Church. They're down, one of the members, Brother Ray Weir, they were without a pastor. They've had several pastors come and go, but they're down to about, when we were there, it was just booming and going. Our youth program was booming and going, but they have no youth. fit that mold. Not what we want, but the mold that God gave for His church in Acts. What does that look like? I pray that you have some kind of, somehow, some way, some similar view. You can, if you miss some of those messages on your way to work, if you're bored, you can listen to them on YouTube. We posted nearly every one of them on YouTube, especially during the pandemic. But now we come to the 61st message that God has given us from the 28th chapters of Acts. Unless God gives us a different direction, today we will close this book. Our journey will have been complete for the past 16 months. We've dug out secrets of God's Word, but we close this chapter, and we're going to summarize Acts chapter 28. Last week I told you there's three things that God highlighted for us, was to shake off those snakes in your life, those toxic relationships, whatever is toxic in your life, get rid of it. And then I told you not only that, but I told you to magnify Him. Everywhere you see Paul, you study Acts, you see that it always starts with God. It always starts with prayer and then the mission. And then finally I said, Paul looked at those there on the island of Malta and said, hey, I've got to keep going to Rome. After 3 months of being in a nice, comfortable place where everybody's treating you with prestige, now Paul says, hey, I've got to keep going to Rome. So today we close. What can we find out about Acts 28? We see a book that's going to abruptly come to an end. There's no ending. There's no conclusion. It just ends. What will God show us in these last few verses? And I pray that the wisdom God gives you today, that you'll be able to walk out of here with. You stand with me in honor of reading God's Word. We're going to pick up in verse 15. We studied the first part of that. Now 15, we're leaving. Verse 15. And from thence, when the brethren heard of us, they came to meet us as far as the Pariforum in the three taverns, whom when Paul saw, he thanked God and took courage. Father, thank you for the reading of your word. I pray now, God, as we complete this book, Father, that we would not be an ending, but only a beginning. God, as we complete this study, God, as your words are magnified, as your words come off the page, I pray, Father, we could come together as one, God, and make sure our life, God, each individual in here makes up the church, God. So I pray our life, God, makes up this book, God, and the mold that is set forth in this book, God, is the mold that we apply our lives to. I pray, Father, if there's correction and to be done, that today it would be done. I pray today, Father, you'd speak to us like never before. God, if it means sacrifice, if it means giving up, if it means surrendering, I pray today, Father, that decisions will be made based on your word and your sweet spirit as it begins to speak and begins to talk to us. Father, help us now these next few minutes. Speak to us the words that each and every one of us need to hear. This would be my prayer today in Jesus' name. And all of us said, amen, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. So what can we learn from Acts? What can we finish up here? Well, there are the first few things. This is one of my favorite verses to preach. When I talk about Acts, when I talk about all the experiences, this verse is always highlighted because it's always a great encouragement to me. So the very first thing, if I was going to say, hey, let's take out the, see what God will show us here at the ending of the book, well, the first thing God would say, hey, church, this is the first thing I want you to do. It's the church you see here in verse 15. It's the unnamed church. It's the unnamed individuals. It's not great titles. It's not people. The Bible says there's people that came. That people is the church. So for you and I to see what the Word of God says, it says not only does the people come, but it also says that these people come from three taverns, whom when Paul saw, he thanked God, and here it is, and took courage. So the first thing that God began to say is, hey, Ray, in the ministry, in your Christian life, in your discipleship, the very first thing God says is, I need you to go the extra mile, period. Go the extra mile. I was in Florida recently, and there was about a 50 to 60-year-old man that nearly drowned, and his wife come over there, and she was running, looking for a lifeguard. And me and my partner were sitting there on the beach, and he jumped up, and he said, ma'am, where is he? And she's like, I need a lifeguard. I need a lifeguard. I don't know if it's says Paul was encouraged. So that tells me, if you just picture the scene, there's a road that runs from these three taverns in Appii Forum that goes to Rome. It is the Roman road. It's the main section of the Roman road. It would have been the most traveled highway, the only traveled highway. You would have had slaves. You would have had caravans. You would have had families walking to Rome. You would have had this busy, huge road, and all of a sudden you see these people, and they come, and they're cheering. You're like, what in the world's going on? Everybody would have been wanting to know, what is going on? Why are all these people cheering? What's the big deal? And it's just one ship just slowly making its way down the coast, and all these people are waving, and they're shouting, and they're cheering. And people would have begun to say, hey, I've been there. When I used to do escorts with celebrities, then we'd come in, and people, especially at ball games, we'd escort a lot of celebrities to football games. You have three or four cars, and you'd have three or four cars behind them, and everybody's just looking and looking and looking, and then when they see the celebrity get out, they all start cheering, and everybody's like, who's there? Who's there? You know what I'm saying? They want to know. Everybody's just talking. What's the big deal? What's the occasion? And what Paul sees here, I can see him on an old bed. I can see him there sitting there, maybe praying, man, God, have I made the wrong choice? Maybe he's tired. Maybe he's hungry. Maybe he's felt like, did I leave the wrong choice? Did I make the wrong choice when I left Ephesus? 3 years the church was blowing and going in revival. 3 years there were people eager every day and night to come and sit, and they're hungry for the Word of God. Did I make the wrong choice? God, did I make the wrong choice to leave Jerusalem when I had an opportunity to begin to profoundly impact those, but yet I appealed to Caesar? God, did I make the right opportunity to leave this little island of Malta? For 3 months we've been took care of. For 3 months they've come and sit and ask about the Word of God. Did I make the right opportunity? How will the people in Rome treat me? How will this pagan society, if I'm going to share the gospel, will I be welcome? Will I be accepted? God, I'm just needing some fuel right now. I'm needing some encouragement right now. And the Bible says I can say, hey. And Paul, looking up at his Luke, you've got to come see this. And there's cloths, and there's towels, and there's hankies, and people waving. What's going on? What's going on? The man of God is on that ship. Just a couple years ago, about 10 years ago, he penned us these words in Romans chapter 1, verse 10 and 12, making a request, if any by any means now, at length I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you, for I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gifts to the end that you may be established. Verse 12, that is, that I may be comforted together with you by mutual faith, both of you and me. They don't even know Paul, but for 10 years they've waited on his arrival, and somebody has run ahead and said, Paul is on the next ship coming in. The one who wrote us this letter here, the Roman society, the one who sent us this letter, he's actually going to come. He's actually on that ship. And for miles, people begin to walk 50 miles, 30 miles, as far out as Appii Forum to begin to escort Paul in. Man, and the Bible says he was encouraged. Why was he encouraged? Because all these church members, if you will, went the extra mile. You know good and well there's people that said, well, why are they doing that? He'll be here in another 8 or 9 hours. Why would you walk all the way that far? You know there's church members that said, man, that's going to cost a lot. You know you're going to have to get a meal going there and a meal coming back. He's on his way. Why can't we just wait for here at the dock for him to get here? Because God impressed on someone, go and meet my servant, and encourage him. And it was simply by going an extra mile, just an extra mile. When you look, man, when you look past the deed of just simply welcoming him, you overlook the Word of God that said Paul was encouraged. On a ship of slaves headed to the final assignment, tired, scared, broken, and have left several successful church plants, Paul is encouraged. Thoughts must have run through his head over and over, will they welcome me? And yet now he begins to see people cheering on God's hero, and he's encouraged. Going the extra mile. We don't know what these men and women are, but they went the extra mile. Just this little small mission they conducted, it would turn out to be a great big deal in Paul's life. If you want to think about the encouragement, if you look past the deed, you see Paul, he got a shot of boldness. He got a shot of encouragement that carried the next few years. Boldness to stand and expound all day and night. Boldness to stand before Nero and all his emperors. Boldness to begin to proclaim to the emperor guard. Boldness to write Philippians, Ephesians, Colossians, and Philemon there as his own health rest. Paul was fueled for his last journey. If you look at God's Timothy that went the extra mile to bring him his cloak, and he was encouraged. It was the Good Samaritan that went the extra mile to go just and spend a little extra time, and there was encouragement. It was Paul that went just this little extra mile over and over, the extra work, and there's encouragement. Over and over in God's Word, when you see people going the extra mile, whether it's Genesis or Revelation, you will always see the outcome of going the extra mile is encouragement. Encouragement is one of your missions as a church. It's edification, which is encouragement, and it's evangelism. When you and I begin to go the extra mile, you'll see God begin to encourage His servants. God begin to encourage each other. God begin to encourage the faith family. And let me remind you, when it comes to going the extra mile, you don't need to look anywhere past the cross of Calvary. And Jesus went just an extra mile for your sin and for my sin. You want to go just a little extra mile for Him to go a little farther to pray for you and me. If that don't bring you encouragement, if that don't bring you boldness, that our Father sits and is our advocate, that begins to cry out, that begins to proclaim, that begins to say, He is mine. Something is wrong with the church. My goodness. It's the extra mile. Wow. Church, look beyond why bringing your family to church is important. It gives more confidence, more boldness to continue on. Look beyond, does it really matter to come to revival? Does it really matter to go the extra mile, to teach a class, to write a card, to help with VBS, to participate in a cornhole tournament, to cook a cake, to make goodies? Why? Because hidden beneath the surface is encouragement. I would tell you your mission, church, is to encourage. And encouragement comes by going the extra mile. When you look behind these pages, wow, what I really like. You see, that picture God can take and put in a spiritual application. It's a picture of you and I sailing to our final destination. We know that Paul was killed in Rome, so we know he's headed to his death. It's that spiritual application, knowing you and I are headed to our death. Wow. We're headed to our final assignment, everyone in this room. And if we just think for a second, we may be in prison, we may feel like our work is done, we may feel like we're just absolutely at rope's end. Look through your spiritual eye and look at that main road. You begin to see those invisible witnesses. Those that have went on. You see, that Roman road is actually the great cloud of witnesses. And they're waving. And they're cheering. Because you're on the same boat they were. Come home. Come home. Come home. It's the men and women that sat here 50 years ago. It's the men and women that laid bricks on this church. Keep going. It's some gentleman or some lady that mowed this lawn before this church ever sat down here. They're waving, they're cheering you on. I couldn't help when I was writing this and studying, just thinking of Pastor Marcos. There's a smile on his face. Come on. Come on. I can see my board member, Pastor Andy. I can see Brother Pete. I can see all these great believers saying, keep running. Keep running. Give you an example of just a little extra mile for me. 15 years ago, my mentor, I can still hear his voice as he speaks these words. His life is my example. These were not just words. He went the extra mile. The office of a bishop, pastor, this desire comes from within the heart. Jeremiah, then I said, I will not make mention of him, the Lord, not to speak any more in his name. But his word was in my heart as a burning fire, shut up in the minds, and I was weary with forbearing it, and I could not stay. There is no such thing as burnout with God called men to the office of bishop. His word is a burning fire from within. The bishop should be a competent leader in the church. And he learns this in his own household, namely his wife and children. When men are called to commit their life to the ministry, we need to keep in one heart and mind the words spoken of our Lord Jesus Christ to his disciples in John's Gospel. You have not chosen me, but I've chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you shall of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things some believed the things which were spoken, and some believed not. Now Paul has arrived at Rome. He's been placed on house arrest, but they do not forbid the Jews from coming. These Jews have gotten his letter. They can't wait to see and ask Paul to clarify what he's talking about this way, or what he's talking about the gospel. And so now verse 23 and 24 tells you that they set aside a day, and Paul, he persuaded them, if you will, from day to night, trying to persuade them of the gospel of Jesus Christ, having confidence in the word of God. He started with the prophecy, went to the Psalms, he went throughout, and showed them that how Jesus was the Messiah. And then the Bible says in verse 24, for you and for me, for those that just get frustrated, and for those that wonder if you're doing any good, he said, and some believed the things which were spoken, and here it is, and some believed not. Why is that important? Number two, if you can ever master this discipline, wow, discouragement will be far from you. Remember, you are just the messenger. This is one thing that God reminds me of often. Why? Why won't someone surrender? Why won't they just give in? God, why? Why? I don't understand why. Why they live like this and why they live like this and do like this. God, I don't understand, because it doesn't line up with your words. Father, help me. I can't make them understand. God said, you can't. Because I've just called you to be the messenger. The inner work comes from the Holy Spirit of God. You cannot do the work of the Holy Spirit. And even times in my ministry, I have failed at trying to be the Holy Spirit. I want people to succeed. I want marriages to flourish. I want our children to grow up to be disciplined in the God's Word. I want people to understand how much God loves them. But that's the Holy Spirit's work. I just watched a video yesterday. Someone explained this to me. I'm fascinated by it, Tony. Somebody on Cocoa Beach recorded little turtles hatching out of an egg. Turtles. And the ground is bubbling up with sea turtles. They're in the sand dunes, so the ocean is about from here to the road. These little dudes are about the size of a little bit bigger than a quarter. And there's hundreds of them. And the ground's just bubbling up with turtles hatching. And so they just start recording it, and they start following all, let's say, 150, 200 of them start immediately headed towards the ocean. Who taught them that? Who told them where to go? You say, well, they can see water. No, they can't. They're smaller than the little rivets of a footprint. They're having to crawl through those. There's little seaweed that's up they have to go around. Who taught those little turtles where to go? They were just born. Who taught them where they're supposed to go? You say, well, it's sound. Well, if you hear something, how do you know what it is if you ain't never heard it before? You're telling me, I just watched that video, and I was so enthralled with, if a man doesn't believe in God, he'll never be able to understand how a turtle that was just born can find an ocean. It's impossible. If you take God out of the equation, it would be impossible. There's no rhyme or reason. How in the world can something that small be born and know that its place is in the ocean when it's never been taught, never been carried there, never seen an ocean, never heard an ocean, never felt an ocean? But it takes off. That's its purpose. Yeah, watch this. You say, oh yeah, I believe in God. If you believe in God to know, yes, there's definitely a God, then why don't you believe in the same God that says, trust me, you can't do this alone. You're going to mess it all up. Just trust me. I know it sounds strange, but you've got to become weak before you become strong. I know that sounds strange, and I know you don't want to do that. In your Western culture, it's actually anti-biblical to think that you can, hey, I can do this on my own. I don't need your help. I don't need anybody's help. I don't need God's help. God is saying, if you're going to become strong, you got to become weak. Trust me. Now, if you believe in God that would create a little sea turtle and show him where the ocean is, but you don't believe a God that he cares enough about you to know the number of your head, something is wrong. And what's happened is you've taken the Bible and you've put it in your mind, and it has never seeped in your heart so that there's a love and a compassion that says, that's my God. Oh, man. That's my God. understand that's my God, then your life is overtaken. Success is not based on numbers or you will fall. Success is not based on human standards. When success is based on our ability to lead someone to Christ, we will fail. Over and over in Acts, I noticed where it wasn't revival everywhere Paul went. Malta, yes. A lot of those cities, they rejected. They refused. They rioted because they rejected the gospel. But yet Paul didn't say, hey, when they rose up, I said, I'm done. My life is too important. I'm going back home. I'm headed back to my city. I'm headed back to Jerusalem. Paul never said that. He just continued on a journey. And so there's an unspoken word that says, remember, you're just the messenger. As long as you remember you're just the messenger, then it's impossible to get burnt out with a message that burns from within the heart of the believer. My goodness. Our duty is to preach the gospel, to live the gospel. Our duty is to simply be a follower of Christ and invite others on the journey. Many will reject. Many will turn back. Many will not want God's word. They will tell us why. The Bible even says, hey, many will not want the word of God. Because Paul, Luke penned right there, he said, I can tell you why. You can find it in Isaiah. Jesus used Isaiah's words. Paul used Isaiah's words. And Luke penned Isaiah's words. What did he say? Well, you look over and he says, well, they'll stop their ears to the message. Pretty simple. They will not listen. Their heart will become hard and they will close their spiritual eyes. God gives us the reasoning so we won't quit. He says they choose to close their eyes. They choose to close their ears. They choose not to see. They choose not to allow the word of God in their heart. At least they would be saved by the power of the gospel. They choose to close it up. I read a commentary this week, stuck with me. It said the same sun that melts the ice is also the same sun that hardens the clay. Think about that for a second. And so thus, we have people that are going to reject and become hard to the gospel. Our duty is to continue to preach. People will not listen. Their heart will become hard and they close their spiritual ear. God gives us the reason so we won't quit. So we'll understand God has already told us up front. Don't get discouraged. I'm telling you, if Jesus used this, if Isaiah was speaking to the children, if Jesus used the same quote, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, then I'm telling you, God is trying to give you and I some evidence so that we won't get down, so the one that we're praying for, so the one that we're waiting on, so the one that we're longing to see them come to Christ, we won't give up and say they'll never get saved. What we'll do is say, God's word says here some believed and some didn't, but our journey is not to put a time on that, but say, hey, I'm going to preach the gospel until my vapor is done. It's going the extra mile, and remember, you're just the messenger. There was no time on how long the prodigal's father watched for his son. There was no time frame on how long Paul would live in Rome. There's no time frame on how long we are to pray for someone, invite someone, or share the gospel with our loved ones. There's only one time stamp on our life. You know what it is? You just have a vapor. You just have a vapor. That's the only time stamp. So that tells me in my life, until my work is done, is to simply be the messenger. Just be the messenger. God has reminded me time and time again, you're not the Holy Spirit. Just share the message. Just share the message. People don't have a problem with the messenger. They have a problem with the message. Don't forget that. It's spiritual warfare. Go the extra mile. Remember you are just the messenger. And then I really like the closing. Verse 31. Be continued. Now, this younger generation, Lily, you're getting older, girl. You had a birthday, didn't you? But you still ain't that old. You still don't know what it's like to have two channels on TV. Still ain't that old, right? Y'all had the two channels on TV. just on and on and on and on. It gets you hooked. If you didn't realize, and I penned this in my book, with the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching those things which concern the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence, no man forbidding him, and then there should be to be continued penned in your book. Why? To be continued. Well, here is Paul's last words that are not in Acts, that while Paul was in Rome here, he penned to Timothy. He said, Timothy, while he's here in prison, he writes a letter to Timothy and said, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me so that I might fully preach the word to all the Gentiles my hill, so that I was rescued from the lions my watch says. The Lord will rescue me from every evil work, I think we missed this, and will bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom. So if you're praying to be rescued from a health emergency, Paul prayed and said, the Lord will rescue me from all my enemies to bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom. A little different from the way we preface our prayer. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. Paul doesn't know when, but he knows his time is getting close to the end. And as Luke closes the book of Acts, it ends with Paul preaching, to be continued. It ends with an open ending. It's an impression to be continued. It is to be continued by the church. It's the acts of the Holy Spirit. In other words, if it is the acts of the Holy Spirit, that means it's the acts of the church of the living God. In other words, those that profess to have the Holy Spirit living in them, to be continued. What is your next act that is inspired by the Holy Spirit that wants to be continued? It's a story somebody's looking, someone's watching, someone's interested in. Miss Janet, what'll be your next act of the little quick recap. Don't